I'll find a funny one someday. John chapter 14. You know what? Let's do this morning. Let's all stand and just read the first seven verses. John chapter 14. Do not let your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my house are many dwelling places. If it were not so, I would have told you, for I go to prepare a place for you. If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also, and you know the way where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you're going. How do we know the way? Jesus said to them, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. From now on, you know him and have seen me. Lord, this is your word. Holy Spirit, speak to our hearts now in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. You know, heart attacks are kind of a modern-day disease. In the mid-1880s, they were so rare that, you know, doctors, when somebody had a heart attack, they would travel pretty far to find out about it, to learn about it, what a heart attack was, you know, how it worked, because they were fairly rare back then. But, you know, today it's like one of the, I don't know if it's the number one disease any longer, but I know for a long time it was the number one disease that killed people in the United States, heart attacks. Some pretty bad stuff. But you know what? There's a bigger heart problem than heart attacks. A bigger heart problem, a troubled heart, a fearful heart, anxiety. It hits the young, it hits the old, it hits the rich, it hits the poor, it hits the famous, and those who are unknown. It hits anyone at any time. You never know if your heart is going to be troubled by something that happens maybe in your life, or you're thinking about it, you're anxious about it, and you get a troubled heart. Sometimes it's gut-wrenching. I almost feel like, you know, last week or something when I was having this stomach thing, it kind of wouldn't go away. I started thinking about it. I was thinking I had a troubled heart. Especially when I was studying this, oh, wow, because in my stomach, it should have went away. And then I was thinking about some things all the time, but things were bothering me. I had a troubled heart. I didn't think about it until I started studying this. Oh, probably what was going on with me. We are all susceptible that kind of attack in our lives. Every one of us. You know, you can go along and you're rejoicing and everything's going great, and then all of a sudden, wham! You can be praising the Lord, and then wham! Oh. And you're down, and then, oh, just kind of hits you. You know, the disciples have troubled hearts at this time. Just think about it. One of them is going to betray Jesus. I mean, that's what they're going on in their minds. That's what they've been going through. You know, Jesus told them. One of you is going to betray me. They're going, ooh, ooh. I mean, that was troubling to them. And then he says, I'm going to go somewhere and you can't go. What? Where's he going to go? I mean, they're, you know, pretty troubling for them. They have a troubled heart. Jesus is leaving. We can't go. And then Peter's going to deny you. Deny him three times. I'm going to deny him three times. I mean, that would be troubling. The Lord told you that. How could that be? I mean, if you took, you know, a vote with the disciples, I would imagine that Peter would be the last one they would ever thought would do that. He would be the last in their vote because his devotion and his zeal that he had for the Lord. They had troubled hearts. That's why I think in verse 1, Jesus said, do not let your heart be troubled. Believe in God and believe also in me. Because they were troubled. Now the cure for that troubled heart is, what is it? Believe in God, believe also in me. That's the cure for the troubled heart. Well, what does that mean? Well, you know, that's what we're going to look at this morning. You know what? It says, let not your heart be troubled. Well, why? Because God is full of love for you. He loves you. You're his child. So why don't your heart be troubled? One reason. Second reason I look at is, let not your heart be troubled. Because God knows what's best for you. And whatever's going on in your life, He knows, and He's going to work it out. So don't let your heart be troubled. Believe in Him. Trust in Him that He's in control. Let not your heart be troubled. Why? Because God reigns from on high. He is in charge. And that wouldn't be there unless He allowed it. Sometimes that gets some of us a little mad and upset. But Father knows best. God knows. And then, let not your heart be troubled. Well, why? If God is for us, who can be against us? Don't we sing that all the time? Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. Hey, God is for us. Who can, you know, they can try to be against us. They can do stuff. But in the end, God wins and we win. I know the end of the story. You know the end of the story. We win. So don't let your heart be troubled, Jesus is saying. Believe in God. Believe also in me. Bringing focus to Jesus and what He was all about. Believe in me, Jesus says. So you put your confidence in one person. You know, we know that, but do we do that? We all know it, but do we do it? Applying it in our lives is different than just knowing it. Trust Him with your whole life, every part of it. Trust Him when it doesn't even seem to make sense. Trust Him. I mean, talk about some of the things that we look at in the Word about not making sense. Look at Gideon. Gideon and Gideon's army. Talk about not making sense. Here it is. There's 135,000 Midianites coming to attack them. And the armies come together with Gideon. And how many do they have? They have 32,000. 32,000 against 135,000. That's not very good odds. It's almost like 4-1. A little 4-1, right? 4-1. Now, you know, you got to be a pretty buff guy to fight four guys. They're all soldiers, right? So, you know, the odds really aren't there. And so what does God tell them to do? He says, you know what? You have too many men, Gideon. Anybody that's afraid, tell them all. We have too many men. I can pretend like I'm Gideon. Too many men? Okay. Anybody that's afraid, go, 10,000 leave. We'll have 22,000. Doesn't make any sense. Okay. So God comes back and says, Gideon, you still have too many men. What? Too many men. Yes. I want you to go down to the river. And when you go down to the river, every one of them kneels down and starts drinking the water on you like a dog. Tell them to go home. In other words, only keep the ones. They go down to the river and they cup their hands, they get the water. Only 300 did that. 300 did that. 9,700. I mean, only 300. But God, there's only 300 of us now. There's 135,000 Midianites. And you know what? He did it. And he believed God. And you know what? In Judges 7, you go ahead and turn there to life. Let's just look at what happened. I love these stories in the Bible. And we have to remember when we read this, our God is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. So He's the same. He does the same thing for us. Okay? Judges, chapter 7, verse 7, says, the Lord said to Gideon, I will deliver you with the 300 men who left, and will give the Midianites into your hand, so let all the other people go, each man to his home. Send them all home, he says. And then in verse 9, he says, now the same night it came about that the Lord said to him, arise, go down against the camp, for I have given it into your hands. You know when he says that, isn't that interesting? It had not happened yet, but he's saying, I have given them in your hands. Past tense. It's already happened. They're yours. And Gideon believed him. And Gideon went forth with these guys. And then jump on down to verse 16, it says, that Gideon divided them, the 300 men, into three companies. He put trumpets with empty pitchers into the hands of all of them, with torches inside the pitchers. So, here's what they're going to go fight with. going to go fight with some lanterns and some trumpets and some pitchers and a candle. I'm sure all the guys down there probably have swords. That's what they're going to fight with. Man, that doesn't make much sense at all to me. But he did it. And then he goes on to say, he said to them, look at me and do likewise, and behold, when I come to the outskirts of the camp, do as I do. When I and all who are with me blow the trumpet, then you also blow the trumpets all around the camp and say, for the Lord and for Gideon. Okay, blow the trumpet for the Lord and for Gideon. Wow. And then verse 20 says, when the three companies blew the trumpets and broke the pitchers, they held the torches in their left hand and the trumpets in their right hand for blowing and cried, a sword for the Lord and for Gideon. Each stood in his place around the camp, and all the army ran, crying out as they fled. When they blew 300 trumpets, the Lord set the sword of one against another, even throughout the whole army. And the army fled as far as Beth Shittah and Zerah, as far as the edge of Abimelech and Tabith. He trusted in the Lord, and look what the Lord did. You know, he could have said, I'm not going to do that. And they would have went ahead and probably lost the battle with the men that they had. But he trusted the Lord. And listen now, once again, the Lord is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. When you're troubled in the spirit, and you don't understand it, just believe in Jesus. Believe in God. Believe in Jesus. Have faith. He's going to come through for you. And he will come through for you. Then in verse 2 and 3, he goes on to say, in my Father's house are many dwelling places. If it were not so, I would have told you, for I go to prepare a place for you. If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. You must trust this place that he has for you. It's in heaven. And Jesus is up there preparing a place for you to live forever. Do you believe that? I do. I can't wait to see it. The house, you know, that I always wanted painted purple, orange, and yellow, but this animal let me have it. Probably be there definitely. I mean, you guys be going down the street saying, hey, there's Mr. Jim's house. Painted purple, orange, and yellow. Probably will get it there. The Father's house. When we talk about the Father's house, where is the Father's house? It's in heaven. Hey, I'm going to go to my Father's house and prepare a place for you. And then I'm going to come back and get you. Man, that's good. That place must be full of love. Must be full of joy. An incredible place. Wow. Listen to Revelation 21. Verse 3 through 5. It says, John speaking, he says, and I heard a loud voice from the throne. You know, he's hearing this loud voice in eternity around the throne. He says, behold, the tabernacle of God is among men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself will be among them, and he will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will no longer be any death. There will no longer be any mourning or crying or pain. The first things have passed away. And he who sits on the throne said, behold, I am making all things new. And he said, write, for these words are faithful and true. You know, it's almost like John has run out of, he hasn't got enough descriptions of heaven to tell what it is. So what does he do? He tells us what's not there. You notice that? He tells us what's not there. Because there's so much there, he tells us what's not there. Because he can't write it all down, I'm sure. Well, what does he say? Death. There's no sorrow. There's no pain. There's no night. I like that. You know, this is the scripture that many times, you know, every time I do a memorial service or a funeral, we use this scripture. But you know what? It doesn't just have to be for the death. It's your life and your heart is troubled. You know, when I go through really intense stuff, sometimes it just gets down to the point of where it's like, hey, you know what? I'm still going to heaven. I know you're preparing a place for me. I'm going to believe in you, Jesus. I know this too will end, even if it ends when I die. That's how it was when I was paralyzed. Well, if I die, I graduate, I'm going to be in heaven. You know, what a wonderful home that it's going to be. No more death, no more crying, no more pain. He's going to wipe away every tear from our eyes. That's comforting to me. I like that. I don't like crying. I don't like pain. I don't like to be sad. And I'm going to spend, and you also, if you believe in Jesus, your whole eternity in that place. Wow. Makes it all worth it, doesn't it? Matter of fact, it says in Romans 8:18 about a troubled heart, says, "For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that is to be revealed to us." You know, Paul, what he's saying is, it doesn't matter how bad it is, it's going to be nothing compared to the glory, to what we're going to see in heaven, what we're going to experience there. This stuff will mean nothing. Won't you? You know, matter of fact, you know, you've heard me say it before. So, why didn't I suffer more, man? And my rewards would have been more. You know, I mean, it's going to be so great. So the sufferings, the things you're going through, let your heart not be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in Jesus. Put your faith and your trust. He's given them promises right here to you and I. Prepare a place for us. What a wonderful hope we have. You know what? Put your confidence in Jesus. Put your confidence and believe. Because you're going to be there. One day, we're going to be standing there, Miss Army, and we're going to be going, "We're here! All those years we've been waiting. Miss Anna, we're here!" It's going to happen. That's what you, I don't know if you do that or not. That's what I assume that we're going to be doing. I don't know. Amongst laughing and singing and praising God throughout eternity. I remember when I was younger, where I really walked with the Lord, you know, that you always heard when you're younger, that, you know, you go to heaven and you're sitting on a cloud with a harp. God, why not electric guitar or something? What a harp, you know? But then when I experienced harp music, I go, yeah, I can sit up and play a harp forever. God, just fine with me, man. Just put me before Jesus. Put me before the Father with a harp. I'm fine for eternity. I don't have anything else. In fact, you know, there's angels around him 24/7 singing, "Holy, holy, holy." And I'm sure they're fine doing that. And just soaking in the presence of God. Soaking in the presence of Jesus. Just knowing who he is. Just being around him forever. Wow. I can't even. That's overamped for my brains. Right? Ooh, just wonderful. Great. Well, he goes on there in verse 4, and he says this. He says, "And you know the way where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you're going. How do we know?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me." These are powerful statements that Jesus is making. This puts an end to all other religions that aren't based on the blood of Jesus Christ, dying on the cross for our sin, being raised from the dead, and believing that Jesus is God. Hey, listen. This Jesus himself says it. "I am the way, truth, and life. No one," not that good person over there that's part of that religion that thinks they're going to heaven, "no one will get there except through Jesus and the blood sacrifice what he did for us." It's not my words. Jesus is not a way. You know, many of the other religions say, yeah, Jesus is a way. You know, there's many ways. Jesus is not a way. He is the way. You know, when we were younger, we used to have this thing, the hippie generation, when we started walking with the Lord, you know, one way. That was our symbol back in the late 60s and early 70s, one way. All the Jesus people, one way. One way. Not closed-minded, right-minded. Not closed-minded. You know, I remember a guy in the 80s wrote a song, a Christian song, and he was talking to people and saying, we're so closed-minded, us Christians, because we could only believe it one way. And he wrote this line, and I stuck with me forever here, you know, because he wrote this line, and it said this. It says, "You're so open-minded that you pray instead." I wasn't about that one. Go to the college kids, you know, open-minded. It says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." See, it's free. For us, it costs Jesus everything, but it's free for us. And all you have to do is believe. You know, we talked about the word believe before. Remember, we probably couldn't bring it out in a minute again. A price must be paid for sin. Jesus paid it. It wipes away any good works to get to heaven. Religious ceremonies, costly gifts, you donating your money. You can't even buy your way in heaven. One of the things that some of the traditional religions, you know, they would go, you know, you would pay your way, buy your way, you know, all of, you know, your sins would be forgiven. Well, give this much, and you're okay. Do this many of these and you'll be okay. I'm not going to talk about religion today. I'm sure somebody has seen that kind of a thing. Why? Jesus' blood. Only way. God's eraser of my sins. Jesus' blood. Well, you would wonder, you know, how could this assurance of going to heaven calm the disciples' hearts? Calms my heart at times when I realize that when I'm going to stuff. Still going to heaven. There was a Dr. James Gray once said, "Who could mind the journey when the road leads home?" What he's saying there is, you know what? We are on this journey of life. But our home is eternity. That's the final destination. We're just passing through. So why, you know, don't mind the journey. Just keep going and keep your focus there. On the finish line, the author and finisher of our faith, Jesus Christ. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Let the stuff happen and we deal with it. We trust in him. And then the journey's not so bad when you think of it that way. Don't mind the journey because you're on your way home, every one of us. And every day that goes by, you are one day closer of meeting Jesus. Because you're going to die, right? If he doesn't come back and get us, hey. You're going to die. That's a fact. 10 out of 10 die. I am going home, going through life. Thank you, Lord. And then he goes and says there in verse 7, "If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. From now on, you know him and you have seen him." You see, when you see Jesus, you see the Father because they are one. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, they are one. One God, three in one, one God. So when you see Jesus, you see the Father. He shows you what the Father is like. You have that understanding when you know Jesus. You know who the Father is. And we don't have to wait to get to heaven. You don't have to wait. You can get to know him now, okay? You know, here, the word know is used 141 times in the Gospel of John, but doesn't carry the same meaning in each time. 141 times. No, listen. I got four different levels of know what it means. First, the lowest level is simply knowing a fact. Yeah, I know that. The sun's up. There it is. Fact. Then the next level is knowing the truth behind the fact. You know why it's up. Because God put it there. But sometimes you can know the fact and know the truth behind the fact and still not be saved. Did you know that? You can know Jesus but not be saved. When it's that kind of a know. You know, yeah, I know who Jesus is and I know why you know that he did that. But still not be saved. The third level introduces relationship, to know in a relationship. And one of the examples of that is John 17:3:3 says this, "This is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent." Did you know him, and the only true God? Did you know him in an intimate relationship? You know what? An example of that in the Bible is how a man knows his wife in Genesis 4:1. It's that kind of a know. He knew his wife. It's an intimate know. Now he's intimate. You're friends. There's a relationship there. That kind of a know. All right? And then the fourth of us is to know means a deeper relationship with a person, a deeper communion. Philippians 3, that I may know him. To know God is eternal life. You really know him. You know, like I tell you many times, the demons believe in Jesus and they shudder. They're not going to be in heaven with us. And there's a lot of people say, "Yeah, I know God. Yeah, I know Jesus," but they're not saved because they never really put that. They don't have that relationship with him. Know him. Know God. Listen, let me give you an example. I know about Prime Minister Barrow, but I don't know him. I know about Brad Pitt, but I don't really know him. You see, you know about God, you know about Jesus, but you really know him. I can pretty much go up and down the same line every week and talk to every person here. Say, "Do you know God?" "Oh yeah." "You know Jesus?" "Oh yeah." Almost everybody. Even the ones that don't confess them or anything. Everybody tells me they know Jesus. When I first came here, everybody knew God. I just didn't see anybody walk with him. They just knew who he was. But I didn't see anybody really walk with him. Now at least we see some people walk with him. You guys are walking with him. And as the people see that, that you really know him because your life has changed, it makes a difference in people's lives. They'll see that. Hopefully, they would desire to have that. So my question to you this morning is, do you know about him or do you know him? Do you really know him? Is there a lot? I've been coming to church here for a long time. And I've heard about him. I know all the stuff. Now what it was like, do you sit and talk with him? That's knowing him. Do you do that? That's knowing him. Do you sit in fellowship with the Father? Do you sit in fellowship with Jesus? Do you know him that way? Or you just know him? You answer that in your own mind. You know. You do or not. Do you trust in him? Do you love him? Have you ever just sat down and said, "You know, I love you, God. I love you, Jesus. To the best of my ability, I love you." You know? Then you know him. If you're in that kind of fellowship and that kind of communion with him, then you know him. And you should be assured when you know him in that way. And I'm not saying, everybody that doesn't do that is going to hell. I'm not saying that. Everybody's at a different place, a different relationship. I'm just encouraging you to do that. Spend that time. Talk with him. Know him on a personal, intimate level. And then you can know this. Do not let your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my house are many dwelling places. If it were not so, I would have told you, for I go to prepare a place for you. If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And he's coming back, and he's going to take you there. And if it just so happens that you decide to exit earth first, well, he's going to meet you. He's going to take you there. The Bible says to be absent from the body is to be with the Father. There's no waiting period. Nobody's going to pray you out of some place. I don't know how all that works. Eternity is eternity. So I don't know how that works, but that's what my Bible says. That's what I tell you. He's going to take you there. He's prepared a place for you. I'm going, man. I am going. Are you going? Let's pray. Lord, such encouraging, great, wonderful words that you give to us. Helps us get through life, Lord. Even this morning, I pray for some of us, Lord, maybe that our hearts are troubled and we've heard this and we say, Lord, I believe in you. I trust in you. I have faith in you. And I know, Lord, that your word is true. And I know, Lord, with that comes comfort. So I pray for those who are troubled this morning. Help them, Lord, just to release it to you, to give it to you, and to continue on, Father, and knowing that you are going to take care of whatever that may be in their lives. I pray for some here this morning that maybe are questioning, do I really know you, Lord? Well, I pray, Lord, that's a question in someone's heart this morning, that as the service ends and we dismiss, Lord, that they will just come and talk to me or someone and say, hey, you know what? I want to make sure I know you, Lord. So I pray, Lord, put that in their heart and pray with them to make sure that they are saved, that they know who you are, not just in their minds, but in their hearts. So thank you, Lord. Thank you for our homes in heaven. We cannot wait to get there and to see you. And Lord, we love you this morning. I love you, Lord. Every way in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Let's stand.